session is going to have two parts. We're going to start out having sort of a roundtable discussion, and Kathy is going to tell you a little bit more, but this is something where we really want you all to feel like it's your time to share your stories, to share your experience, to talk with others about what you've experienced. We will then move on to a session on participating in legislative advocacy and government affairs. That's something that we hear over and over and over again from you all that you're really passionate about, you want to learn more about, you want to know how to be involved. So that will be the second part. We'll probably take about a 5 or 10 minute break in between if you just need to go out and use the restroom or get a drink of water, something like that. So I want to introduce Kathy Lindell. She is on the PFF's board of directors. She also works with the Pennsylvania University in Pittsburgh? University of Pittsburgh, thank you, I'm sorry. And she also has worked with us a lot on the Support Group Leader Network, on all sorts of things that are really patient and family focused. So I am really happy that she's here. Kathy, please go ahead and come up.
So, just to give you a brief introduction to me, if you don't know me. So I am a pulmonary clinical nurse specialist. What does that mean? I have a master's degree in pulmonary nursing. I also have a PhD in nursing that my research focus, I started working in the Simmons Center for Interstitial Lung Disease in 2001. And my charge was to develop the patient support group and patient education efforts. So then I went back to get my PhD, and you have to have a research question. Well, I had already worked with IPF patients for 2.5 years at this point, and my question, it was a natural question that just emerged. What is the disease impact of IPF? Because I was that nurse on the receiving end of the patients after they got the diagnosis. They came out of the doctor's office, or, you know, out of the room, and I was the next step. So I did this study and I actually found, and it's led to my research path, but that's not what we're here to talk about today. We're here to talk about you and your stories, but where I'm leading with that is that every one of you is impacted in some way. So I need just a quick show of hands. How many in here, like our focus today, they broke it down to transitioning after the loss of a loved one and then after a transplant, kind of two different categories, but we're going to marry them together because there's value in both. So how many are here because they recently lost a loved one? Doesn't have to be recent. Did you? Just a simple yes, no, did you lose a loved one? Okay, so that's about half the group in here, okay? Now, how many have had a lung transplant or someone in their family had a lung transplant? Okay. Just for other defining, how many in here are healthcare providers? Okay, so healthcare providers and loss, so we have some, like some crossover. So all of your stories are really valuable, and I have 40 minutes. So on the fly is how we're gonna do this. I would like everyone in this room, if you want to, this is purely voluntary, to tell a very brief story. So 40 minutes, there's about 35 or 40 of you, that's like 1 minute per person. The reason I think this is really important is your story is of a lot of value. And you may not think that because you're immersed in the midst of it, but there are things that other people learn from your story and take away, like, oh, wow, geez, her husband had the same thing. Or, oh, wait, they come a distance. It helps, it's a rare disease, and it helps to put some, you know, just some credence to what you're thinking. So is everyone okay with that idea? Right, natural leader, who wants to go first? John.
Quickly, John, separated, that I was obese, that I was allergic to cats, that I had COPD, and that I was ugly. And finally, in the year 2011, I was sent to Yale. They identified that I had PF and IPF, and they sent me to Columbia in the University of Pulmonary, where 1 year later, and personally, I've been trying to be an advocate to help support groups and other anyone who live with pulmonary disease to overcome and be as strong as they can understand the risks and benefits.
Great. As I said, it's going to be on the fly. Now I'd like somebody who recently lost, or not recently, I can say the reason, who lost someone.
Hi, my name is Madeline Mulder, and I go by Mandy. And this coming Sunday will be the first anniversary of my husband Kat's death. Yeah. So this has been a little difficult for me to be here, but it also has been so rewarding because I have seen how much research is going on in this awful, incredible disease. Kat is not a transplant candidate. We have other various diseases. The diagnosis idea what it was. He was being worked up for sleep apnea, and then he discovered he had IPF. And over 2 years, the doctor told him he had crap increases in his lungs. So what can I say? He was on, two things I want to say. He was on OFEV for about 14 months, and that gave us the last year of his life, in which he got to see both his children's brand new homes. We got to celebrate our 50th wedding anniversary, and I got into the ocean, which was a joy for me. Mm-hmm. I also want to say that if you don't know about Patient Services Inc., they have a booth out here. They provided the 20% that Medicare did not pay for OFEV. And if you all don't know about the cost of OFEV and what Medicare pays, Medicare paid $8,400 a month, and Patient Services Inc. paid the other $700. So tell your friends and family to donate money to PFF and IPF. Thank you.
Journeys that people are on after they've lost somebody. here. My sister and mother and I are from Minnesota. My dad passed away in May of 2015. He had IPF for about 3 years before he passed away, or was diagnosed about 3 years before he passed away. He was the rock of our family, the silent, quiet type, but always the one we would go to for everything. He like held everything together. He was just like you could say nothing bad about him. He had a PhD in organic chemistry and worked at 3M for a number of years, and he researched the hell out of IPF when he found out that he had it. And he got himself figured out that he wanted to go to National Jewish to get more information and more diagnoses and information. And so we went there, and he got more information and was told that's where he had interstitial lung disease. And but we went through everything at the University of Minnesota. And he had ended up with a pneumothorax, and so couldn't, for quite a while, do his 6-minute walk test to, allow his LAS number to get high enough to get him on the transplant list. And so by the time his pneumothorax healed enough for him to do his 6-minute walk test again, he shot up to the top of the list with you. And by that point, he was so weak. But he got his double lung transplant anyway, and he was doing a little bit probably harder recovery than most people. He's 65, very, very thin to begin with. He had already had a feeding tube placed and had been really weak, really, to begin with. And then he was doing really well, and had finally headed for inpatient rehab program. And then 2 days before inpatient rehab program, the center where he was staying before he moved there, he ended up having a cardiopulmonary arrest. And he just from that ended up with too much hypoxia or lack of oxygen to his brain. And so unfortunately, I see it now as we've tried to help him rehab more, but he suffered, I think, for 7 more months before we finally decided he has a living will. This is how he wanted to live. And so that's when we brought him home. And he was at home for 3 days before he passed away on Mother's Day.
Thank you for sharing.
So another really important story. That I want to emphasize that she said, because you should have a takeaway from each story. Your dad was the rock of your family. That's what I heard.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
And so I hope that you can take solace in his memories.
Oh, yeah. Every day. Thank you.
Okay. Who? That was a transplant and a loss of a loved one. So who has their burning desire to tell their story? First hand up.
My name is George Kaminsky. I'm from Vancouver, Canada. I was diagnosed with IPF in 2011. I wasn't new to me because my brother had IPF. He was diagnosed in 2003, received a double lung transplant and a heart transplant at the same time in 2007. So when I was diagnosed, the hardest thing for me was we knew about the disease in a limited way. We knew that it was a terminal disease. I have 2 young boys. And the hardest thing for me was to tell them that father might die in a short time. In 2012, about a year after my diagnosis, I started going downhill very quickly. But I was fortunate to get on the transplant list and was transplanted in 3 weeks after getting the So my focus is, I have my two sons. I want to make sure that I can do anything and everything for them in the future.
Thank you.
So again, another transplant and loss of loved one.
My name is Judith Friedman. My husband started not feeling well in about 2004, and we didn't really know what it was. And we traveled out to Denver to the Jewish
National Jewish.
We went to the Mayo. We went to Mount Sinai. And finally, in 2010, he was diagnosed at Columbia Presbyterian with pulmonary fibrosis. Unfortunately, he was not so lucky because he could not get on the transplant list. And I remember very clearly when we spoke to his pulmonologist. John was a great lawyer. John said to him, "If I don't get the transplant, how much longer will I be able to live?" And the doctor very reluctantly answered anywhere from 6 months to a year. And actually, 6 months later, John died at the age of 66. So I'm really here because until 2011, we had never really even heard of pulmonary fibrosis.
How many of you have had challenges with your physicians getting an accurate prognosis or getting any prognosis at all? About half of you. I'm not a very advocator, I think that physicians in general have a very difficult time with prognostication. And your physician was pretty close, so overestimated by a little bit, 6 to 12 and maybe 6. And that's one of the frustrations of the disease. How do you plan? How do you plan accordingly when you are not a transplant candidate and you know that you have a critical process going on? And the only caveat take home on that is that when you do have that opportunity to understand that, to be living life as fully, being as productively as possible. There's all sorts of caveats. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. We get by a bus. I hear all the time from people, who knows. Well, we don't know. And that's why, if we understand that that's the end point, even though we don't know when that endpoint is going to be, we can begin to live fully, productively, and meaningfully, and make decisions according to what is important to us. Thank you.
To be fierce and to be questioning and to be strong. And, you know, I just think, oh, you know, I'm that pushy New Yorker, you know, that's a stereotype, but guess what? It works. And it's okay. They're really okay with it. They're as excited about the prospect of solving these problems as we are. So I would just urge you all to become fierce advocates. And Ralph is still with us. It's 7 years. And yes, I mean, he has his struggles and whatnot, but he's really working, so just keep going. There you go.
Is this having a baby hard pregnancy? and loved him. I would follow him every last question. And Andrew followed my journey and had a program by biologist and generally. So everything, you know, pulmonary fibrosis is amazing. Only one thing, one more, which was in my ICU room when I was in NICU was never give up. So that is the lesson I think we should all take the class today.
Thank you.
Bill Vick, you didn't talk. Do you want to talk? Okay, that's fine. How about Mrs. Vick? Would you like to talk? Okay.
I would just, I'm about the caregiver. I think that the caregiver burden for those of us that are higher functioning may be a little bit worse for the caregivers than those who really have needs. We tend to argue and fight that.
Agreed.
Thank you.
is really good because it connects all of us. But here's why, as a nurse, here's my worry about social media. And this is where you are what we call our foot soldiers, because you have a lot of access to a lot of people. I see a lot of people coming on Facebook and asking medical advice questions to the group. Safety-wise, you need to refer them to their physician or to a physician or to the Pulmonary Fibrosis Call Center. That is a wonderful resource. And because the whole idea is you want to keep it safe. Here's an example of a question. A patient writes, is it normal to have diarrhea and whatever, one of the meds? Okay, safety-wise, please contact your physician so that they know and they can guide you. Really, you should have patient, you know, to get safe medical care. So that's my ask of all of you, because you're out there and you are really, you have your tentacles into the community.
We just want to thank you all for coming in here to be vulnerable and to share your stories. They are inspiring, they are encouraging. For those of us that are on the kind of front end of the transplant curve, we hear those and we say, I'm also very sensitive. I want you to be aware that there are many people in here who will not do well, who have had loss for people that did not do well. And this can be sometimes a frustrating and a discouraging environment when they say, not necessarily why me, why him. I lost my dad when he was 53 years old. And so when you talk about losing the rock in your family, I still tear up. It's been 37 years and I still tear up over that, that type of a loss. And my mom still, 37 years later, at the age of 94, says, well, why did that happen to him? Okay? So that's very, very real, and I encourage you to use these opportunities to talk with people, and you may not necessarily feel as inspired by someone's story because yours was not as positive or encouraging. Someone in one of the sessions yesterday commented that, you know what, half the people who have been through this experience aren't here because they're not feeling well enough to. And we must be ever vigilant about that. And that ever so augments the need for a strong patient advocacy and legislative advocacy, because that's how we're going to be able to make a difference for those that don't do well, those that haven't done well, and those who would follow us that need to do well. It's encouraging to see the upswing in transplants, to see the extension of life expectancy, but that still is a very small percentage of those living with IPF. Most of those living with IPF will progress to death with their disease, and we need to be ever vigilant about that. And we're very, very sensitive to that, and we want just to, you know, this is a safe place for tears and for feeling that frustration, that sorrow, and sometimes anger, and we just wanted you to know that we're sensitive and we feel very strongly about that. I know the family and we're going to be around for another couple of days. You just want to pull us aside because you just want to share something or share a story that you didn't feel comfortable with the audience here. Our ears are open, our shoulders are here. Thank you.